Welcome to Your Voice, a show where you can see how your voice is being heard in the New York State Senate. I'm Julia Locandy. Today I am joined with Senator Martins. Senator Martins, thank you so much for being with us
again.
It's
great to be here, Julia. Thank you.
You know, when you were here last week, you told us about hosting the Secretary of State from Portugal in Mineola.
Right.
So tell us about it. You brought pictures as promised.
Yeah, absolutely. We held an event on Saturday. This is the Secretary of State. That's a photo of her. Teresa Moraes. She is the Secretary of State for Equality from Portugal. She was coming in, actually made a presentation to the United Nations on Monday, but she came in a couple of days earlier to participate in this forum. It was very interesting. Not only did she give us a briefing on events in Portugal right now, certainly the economic impacts of this recession in Europe are significant, and they're feeling it. So she gave us a broad overview, but she also gave us some insight on some of the women's issues that they're dealing with in Portugal, and it's remarkably similar to the issues that we're dealing with right here in New York. So it was very interesting. One, it was great to have her. Two, the outpouring of support from the community. We probably had well over 200 people there, but the ability to connect with the community. And to specifically the Portuguese community in Mineola was pretty impressive. These issues transcend boundaries. Mm-hmm. They're issues that resonate. Certainly the financial issues that they're dealing with and how they're dealing with it is significant. So we know we're not alone, even though it's a whole different continent, a whole different country. They're struggling through the same things that we're struggling through. Budgetary constraints, overspending, the need to cut, the need to prioritize and determine where to cut. So they're doing that as we speak. And certainly they're coming from a different place and probably a more difficult place than we are here in New York and here in the United States. It was interesting to hear her perspective on those issues. But on the women's issues, remarkably similar. And when you talk about pay inequity, things that we talk about here, understanding that it's the same there. 86% earning 86% of what a male makes. It's unacceptable. And certainly the fact that we have so many different groups working on the same issues is somewhat reassuring. She made a great point. More than half of university students in Portugal right now are women. And we can say the same thing here in the United States. The majority of people going on to universities are women. The vast majority of those also go on to earn higher degrees. If we have that kind of that broad scope of people seeking higher education, going on for higher degrees, why don't we see more women as CEOs? Why don't we see more women on boards of directors for many of the larger companies in the United States? She gave the figure that only about 4% of members of boards of directors were women in Portugal. And I think if we went back and looked at the same statistics here in the United States, we're going to find that it reflects more or less the same statistic. How do we justify that? Right. When you consider the fact that that we have come as far as we have. Mm-hmm. So where is that blockage? Where is the roadblock to women being in places of success? I don't know necessarily that we legislate it, but I think it's important that we highlight it, that we recognize it, and then we take steps to try and address it. So it was a great visit. She was fantastic. And again, for me, I was able to present her with a copy of the governor's State of the State book, that 300-page book that he put out, mm-hmm. Because I wanted to show her that the issues that she was speaking to were remarkably similar to the same issues we're dealing with here in New York.
Yeah, great idea. So I want to move on now and continue with the investigation that you have been involved with to help people who are affected by Sandy get back in their homes and their businesses up and running again. You brought a very serious issue to the Banks Committee the other day, and I want to take a look at that right now.
Thank you. The regulations that require that the bank perform its due diligence prior to endorsing those checks, are there limits in those regulations, time limits within which they do have to endorse and return those checks, or is it at the discretion of the bank?
I'm not sure there's any laws around that return, but certainly at Chase, we have a two-day standard. And that includes if we receive the check on Monday, that those funds, if in fact these are current loans, will go out overnight on Tuesday and be received by the customer on Wednesday.
And that would be, I believe, I don't have it in front of me, within the best practices of the superintendent. So I think speaking for the industry, that that would be viewed generally as an industry practice.
At least that which was relayed to me personally and that which I've heard anecdotally is that these checks have taken, in many instances, weeks to be endorsed and returned. And so I would ask that we look into that to see perhaps, irrespective of whether Fannie and Freddie have relaxed their rules over the course of the last week, in those first nearly 4 months, appears to have been a practice, because it didn't happen just once or twice. These are instances that have been relayed on a number of occasions, mm-hmm. Where perhaps the industry needs to reevaluate how quickly it responds to those necessary precautions that the industry takes to protect its collateral, but at the same time, understanding that given the scope and breadth of this emergency and the impact to individuals, businesses and communities, that there is a responsibility on the part of the banks to move right. as quickly, sir, as you've mentioned that J.P. Morgan Chase does. And I would perhaps say that it has been, again, relayed to me that that has not been a universal experience. And to the extent that there aren't regulations that cover it, certainly federal or state, I would hope that the industry would take a more proactive approach to address those concerns, especially when we're dealing with instances such as this.
We support the processing of those checks as swiftly as possible. There are rules in clearing that are outside the domain of the state of New York. The Federal Reserve has clearing rules, but they do not, how many checks are affected. The extent of the delays is something that we certainly would take seriously and look at and talk to the DFS about.
I would also assume that if we're dealing with insurers, we're dealing with the insurers that we deal with every day, that the possibility of those checks not being covered is something that you should take into consideration as well. And I understand the concerns you have with regard to clearance and checks clearing, but I mean, there's a minimized risk here, is there not, on the part of the industry in their ability to be able to not only receive but then transmit funds as well?
I would say that at Chase, we are not waiting for checks. So that if there's that two-day process, we're not making a phone call to Allstate or Allstate's bank to see whether that check is right. going to clear. So that's not part of our process at all. So, you know, clearly there are exceptions, but our process, which is measured every day, because we believe this is a real emotional, they want that money back as quickly as possible. And the fact that we don't have to, but we're sending it out FedEx, eliminates a couple days worth of postal time. For each one of the disbursements, we don't use clearing as a delay tactic, and it's not even in our process.
I don't think, speaking for our members and those services who are around our group, including John, we would want to look at this claim and see where that problem exists, because we certainly would ascribe and support the quick clearance of these checks when they're received.
I appreciate that. And just to follow up on a point the chairman had made earlier with regard to inspections, I'll give you a different scenario. You mentioned the scenario where the insurance company cut the check, they've done their inspection prior to their cutting the check, now you go back and inspect it. And it works sequentially. But we do have instances where insurance companies issue partial checks, and then there's an inspection to make sure that the work's been done, and then they issue another check, and the bank then comes back. And in those instances where there are multiple checks cut, and then multiple inspections, there is an overlap between the function of inspections by insurance companies and banks, and to that extent I would hope that there would be an opportunity to streamline that process, since the bank's inspectors and the insurance company inspectors, at least has been my experience, are different, and sometimes there's a delay associated with that.
I have to say, from my perspective watching that, you know, how can they say they want to take a look at the claim? They haven't heard this already over and over again?
That was the odd part. And certainly you had a representative there from J.P. Morgan Chase. And I'll say that perhaps they do it right. And I have no reason to believe that they don't. But I can tell you that I have heard example time and again, and certainly have heard examples from my colleagues relaying nightmare scenarios where not only does a person have to wait for the insurance company to come in, do their inspection, do their due diligence, but they finally negotiate the claim and finally get to a point where the insurance company cuts a check. They get that check, it's double endorsed because they have a mortgage. They send it off to the bank, oftentimes in another state, mm-hmm. and then they wait literally weeks for the check to be processed. And so there is a concern there. There should be a concern there, and there should be a consequence there. Yeah. You're getting a check from Allstate for X amount. That check is necessary for that homeowner to begin rebuilding. And the process should not take weeks, it should take days, and it hasn't. So to the extent that there are regulations that we should be looking at as a state, you know, we also spoke to the Department of Financial Services to have them look at it. But to the extent that there is need for legislation, then the responsibility is also on us. And I think there's a process that needs to be in place.
Yeah.
Everyone has to protect themselves. Certainly we don't want the banks defrauded. We don't want insurance companies defrauded. But when there is an emergency, and there's an emergency on this scale, we have to process things more quickly. And there has to be a consequence to holding on to checks and allowing them to sit there for weeks when people are waiting for those checks as an opportunity to rebuild and get back into their homes. So we're working on it.
Right. You have been asking those questions, and week by week you've been coming in here and giving us bits and pieces of trying to find a solution for these people. So we'll keep an eye on that.
Absolutely.
Developing story, martins.nysenate.gov.
That's right.
I want to talk to you now about novelty lighters. You want to ban them.
Sure.
And you have great support behind you of firefighters who agree. So tell us about the legislation that you sponsor.
Well, look, we see them oftentimes on convenience store counters. You see these lighters that they're fun. You think they're great. They look like toys. Problem is, they're not toys.
Right.
They're lighters. Our children will play with them and inadvertently end up either burning something, hurting themselves, causing fires, which in turn requires our fire services to respond. It's an unnecessary risk. It's an unnecessary attractive nuisance to our children. And there is no reason why we should have a lighter that looks like a car. There is no reason why we should have a lighter that looks like a toy animal, you know, a teddy bear, or you know, any one of those things that you see right there.
Mm-hmm.
There really is. There's no reason for that to be a lighter. And it's one thing when it's limited to adults, but the reality is they're getting into the hands of our children. There are examples of incidents where fires have been started, people have been hurt, children have been hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And in turn, again, our emergency services or firefighters are called out to respond to these fires. And we have a responsibility. If there's something we can do to prevent a fire, if there's something we can do to prevent an attractive nuisance like a novelty lighter from falling into the hands of someone who may not necessarily know what the consequences of their actions are, like a child,
mm-hmm.
then we have to do it. And so all this bill does is, you know, draw a line in the sand. We're no longer going to allow these things in this state. There are 15 other states in the country that regulate novelty lighters. Five of them have absolute bans on them altogether. And I feel not only is it appropriate, it's long overdue. I don't know why it's taken this long for New York to get to this point, but it's long overdue.
Okay. Thank you so much for being with us today, Senator.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Jack Martins. For any information on the issues we discussed, martins.nysenate.gov.